Hey everyone, and welcome back to Hoffman Engineering. Today I'm reviewing the Ender-7 by Creality, a beefy 3D printer advertising 250mm per second print speeds. But can it really achieve such blazing speeds? Let's find out. Before we get into it, a quick disclaimer. This printer was graciously sent to me for review by Creality3D.shop, an online retailer of Creality 3D printers and accessories. I'm not getting paid by them, and they won't see this video before it goes public. Everything that I say is my own honest opinion. If you do find the Ender-7 interesting, you can find more information at Creality3D.shop, links in the description. And they are gracious enough to give my viewers 10% off an Ender-7 if you use the coupon code HOFFMANE7 at checkout. With that out of the way, let's talk about the specs. The Ender-7 is a filament-based 3D printer from Creality. It has a build volume of 220mm by 220mm by 300mm. It comes with a 0.4mm nozzle and uses 1.75mm filaments fed by a Bowden extruder. It has a core XY gantry, which means instead of there being one motor for the X-axis and one motor for the Y-axis, instead, it has an intricate belt loop where two motors work together to move the pot end in the X and the Y directions. This allows the motor to be stationary and uses the torque of both motors to control the hot end. The gantry also uses linear rails for the X and Y axes. These design decisions is what allows for the 250mm per second print speeds. The nozzle has a larger melting zone to help with such high speed printing. Melting is only half the battle though. Once the plastic is printed, it also needs to be rapidly cooled down before the next layer is printed. This cooling is provided by dual cooling fans on either side of the hot end. The extruder also needs to be able to push enough filament, which the all-metal, dual-geared extruder is easily able to keep up. It even has its own cooling fan to help prevent the extruder from overheating during long prints. The extruder also has a filament runout sensor, which will pause a print if you run out of filaments. After you replace the filaments, it'll resume where it left off. The Ender-7 has a heated, silicon carbide print bed, which is mounted cantilevered on the single lead screw Z-axis. Four spring-loaded screws attach the bed to the Z-axis and allows for manual bed leveling. Moving down to the base, we can see the 4-inch touchscreen display. The firmware makes it easy to adjust settings, monitor prints, load filaments, and it even helps with bed leveling by moving the hot end to the four corners. The firmware also includes power loss recovery, so if the print loses power mid-print, it can remember where it left off and prompt you to resume printing once power is restored. There will be a slight seam, but a seam is better than losing a multi-day print due to power loss. On the side of the printer is a micro SD card slot, as well as a USB Type-C port for connecting the printer to a computer. The Ender-7 also comes with various accessories in the box, including an 8GB microSD card, a microSD card to USB-A reader, a flush cutter, a scraper, and all the tools needed to assemble the machine. It also included a 0.5kg of PLA filament. Mine was white. So with the specs out of the way, let's talk about print quality. Overall, the print quality is amazing. This God of Wealth G-code was included on the microSD card and was the very first print I printed after assembly. And it turned out great. The surfaces are smooth, the layers are consistent, and the included white PLA printed just fine. The Ender-7 is able to handle 0.1mm to 0.3mm layer heights with no issues. At reasonable speeds, it prints near the top of class quality-wise. But we aren't here for reasonable speeds. We want to push the speeds towards the advertised 250mm per second print speeds. If this normal size 3D Benchy took 2 hours and 30 minutes to print, how long do you think this Benchy took when scaled to the maximum size the print bed allowed? A day? 20 hours? Nope, this took exactly 9 hours. With speeds cranked up to 250 millimeters per second, this printer is flying. 300 grams of filament in 9 hours is impressive. Print quality definitely suffers at those insane speeds, especially on curved surfaces with overhangs, like the hull of this large Benchy. You can see artifacting, and sharp corners have over-extrusion where the printer needs to decelerate and change directions. But for rapid prototyping large objects, where a perfect surface finish isn't as important, I believe the Ender-7 could be a great candidate. With slowed down just a little to a still impressive 150 millimeters per second, most of those surface artifacts go away. This Dragon was scaled to the tallest that this printer can handle, and printed in 15 hours. It was also my only failed print, which I'll discuss more about later on. Ignoring the failure seam near the top of the prints, the quality of the prints is outstanding for a speed twice as fast as I normally run my other printers. If you want to see the print settings for any of the prints I mentioned, you can find links to 3D print log in the description. Aesthetically, I think the Ender-7 is a good looking printer. It looks great sitting on the tabletop, and since the bed only moves up and down, there is no risk of the bed hitting the wall or a passerby like some of the other Ender models. Sound-wise, the motors are quieter than the fans when printing at normal speeds. When printing at higher speeds, though, that's when you'll start to hear the motors. It's still comfortable enough to be in the same room while it's printing. The Ender-7 comes partially assembled, and it took a little over an hour for me to assemble. Thankfully, the most complicated piece, the core XY gantry, was already completely assembled. All we have to do is screw in the vertical pillars to the base and bolt on the gantry. A few screws to attach the bed to the Z-axis, and then some cable management, and we are done. The instructions are pretty clear, and the tools and bolts are all provided. So as long as you can turn an Allen wrench, you shouldn't have any issues assembling the Ender-7. I did run into a couple of issues while testing the machine. As I mentioned before, the Dragon failed about 14 hours into the 15-hour print. It left this beautiful piece of spaghetti, though. What I believe happened was that the cable protector for the hot end came loose during the print. During assembly, the protector is just shoved into a hole at the top of the printer. The protector came loose, allowing the cables to fall into the gantry, and it must have pushed the hot end, causing it to continue printing off to the side. A spectacular fail to look at. I'll probably end up printing a retaining clip to help ensure it doesn't happen again. The second issue I experienced was with the spiral vase mode prints. Many slicers have a spiral vase mode, or spiralize option, which will allow the printer to continuously print while constantly raising the Z-axis. The end result is a beautiful vase with no seams from changing layers. However, printing a spiral vase from the SD card results in stuttering on the Ender-7. Some people think that it's a firmware issue, with the power loss detection that is causing the issue, but you cannot disable the power loss detection through the touchscreen, and using the M413 G-code command didn't fix it. Others online think that it might be an SD card speed issue, where the control board cannot read from the SD card fast enough. I'll probably have a follow-up video where I explore some potential solutions, but until then, spiral vases do work correctly when printing from USB. So if spiral vases are important to you, plan on printing from USB if you pick up the Ender-7. Speaking of firmware, when testing the filament runout detection, I did run into an issue where it wasn't letting me click on the yes to change filament through the touchscreen. Eventually, I clicked on no, but I was able to manually change the filaments and resume printing. So, the firmware isn't perfect, but the features still worked, and I could finish the print. The last concern I have is more of a word of caution for users that like to stick their hand into the printer while it's running. I have a tendency to pull the extra filament away from the hot end as it heats up before it prints. But that happens right as the bed moves to the top, creating a pinch point between the bed and the top gantry if you reach your hand in. So as hard as that habit can be to break, be smart and keep your hands away from the printer while it's printing. Overall, I think the Ender-7 is a spectacular printer. It is a very rigid machine that you can push to some incredible speeds, thanks to the linear rails and Core XY design. As advertised, 250 millimeters per second is not just marketing talk. Combined with a decent print volume, and you'll be able to prototype large objects in record times with this printer. And if you slow it down just a little, you'll have high quality prints. The extra features, like power loss recovery and the filament runout detection, are nice to have, even if they are a little buggy. The touchscreen is pleasant to use, much more user-friendly than the knob controls you normally find. So, how much will the Ender-7 cost you? At around $729, the Ender-7 is one of Creality's more expensive printers. But when time is money, the print speeds the Ender-7 is capable of can be worth the price tag. So if you found the Ender-7 interesting, please find more information at creality3d.shop, linked in the description. And if you want to pick one up for yourself, you can use the coupon code HOFFMANE7 for 10% off. So thank you all for watching. I'm sure I'll have some follow-up videos about the Ender-7. So be sure to subscribe so you don't miss out on any future videos. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comments down below, and I'll be happy to answer them. And finally, check out 3dprintlog.com. It's a free website that I've been developing for 3D printing hobbyists to keep track of all of your 3D prints. So thank you all, and I'll see you all next time.